Hi my dear friends, this is Rayan. You are watching HSC Aspire YouTube channel. Today we will going to discuss oil and gas technical HSC interview questions and answers. If you are new to our channel, please subscribe and press bell icon, also activate notification tab. Then only you will get notification when we upload HSC related videos. Thank you, let us start video now. Friends, in this video, I have explained some oil and gas HSC technical interview questions and answers in briefly. Also, friends, we previously uploaded one HSC related interview question answer video in YouTube in my channel. You can click on above icon so that you can watch that video also. Thank you. Let us start video now. Friends, we will discuss here question number one. What necessary steps should be taken before start an excavation? The employer or supervisor is responsible for the work and must take the necessary steps to identify all hazards and risk before start an excavation work. Friends, here some following steps should be included before doing excavation. Identify the soil types related to the excavation or trench before starting the excavation. Locate all buried surfaces by using cable detectors and metal detectors. Contact the owners of any underground utilities or services that may be in the location and ask them to identify and mark the location. Identify and locate overhead power lines. Make sure the services are de-energized as necessary. Know all of the contact numbers of these services if there is an emergency. Check areas adjacent to the site for potential hazards and sources that can be impact the stability of soil. Be aware that nearby vehicles and the equipment can cause the soil to vibrate and then collapse. Determine if nearby buildings or structures and their foundations may be put pressure on the soil and affect the walls of the trench. Test for hazardous gases, vapors and dust before entering. Test for oxygen levels in the space before entering and during the work as required. Plan appropriate organization of the worksite and good housekeeping practices, including moving debris and excavated soil far enough away from the excavation site. Remove water from the excavation. Protect the workers from falling into the excavation. Identify appropriate personal protective equipment, including high visibility vest for vehicular traffic, and make sure every worker wears them as required. Have a worker above ground when a worker is working in the trench to warn those in the trench of danger and to provide emergency help. Prepare work permits for work in confined spaces as appropriate. Have a means of exit provided from the inside of the trench, usually no more than 7 meters or 25 feet away than any worker in the trench. Plan for adverse weather conditions. Prepare an emergency plan and rescue procedures. Keep first aid boxes at the site. Educate and train workers about all existing and potential hazards and risks and appropriate safety measures. Second question is, what is blinding and what are the safety requirements? What are the safe procedures for blinding and deblinding? Friends, this question also very important in oil and gas shutdown. Here we will understand what is blinding. Blinding means stopping a process flow by placing a properly rated obstruction in a line. It is the preferred method of positive isolation by stopping the process flow line. As a safety, check the following before start blinding. Check the permit is correct for blinding. Get the checklist in which mentioned that the particular line which has to be blind, that is properly isolated, drained and depressurized. Check CTRA, that is critical task risk assessment. The most important thing is the blind list. Note that always do blinding according to the list provided by plant operator and process engineer. Safety arrangements during blinding. Always barricade the particular area where you are going to do maintenance activities or spadding and despadding procedure. Always keep water hose and fire extinguisher for emergency if some hazards happened during spadding and despadding procedure. keep drip tray for collection of fluids which comes during spadding and despadding procedure. Check your tools properly. Always use brass hammer. Use breathing apparatus if required. Note that breathing apparatus is used for safety of dangerous gas like H2S. If H2S gas is more than 15 ppm, then you should use breathing apparatus. Procedure for blinding and deblinding. For blinding and deblinding procedure, always loose bottom side bolts of flange so that if any fluids present in the line, that will drain and depressurize it properly. Always loose bottom side bolt first. Clean the gasket area properly so that gasket will fix in proper way. Note that only we use copper or brass tools, means non-sparking tools, because blinding is mostly done in flow line. Third question is, why need a tripod which if confined space has a ladder? Does the depth of the confined space is a matter? Upon initial inspection and evaluation of the confined space, if it is determined that a person could be injured in such a way that he/she would not be able to self-rescue, example, climb a ladder, then a retrieval system is necessary. If entering a confined space where the potential for a fall could occur, for example, a person could slip or lost control climbing a ladder, then fall protection must be included in the confined space entry system. A self-retracting lifeline with a winch retrieval system provides rescue retrieval for a worker entering a confined space should he/she become incapacitated. It is the responsibility of the employer to evaluate each space separately and develop entry and rescue procedures for each individual space. Generally, according to the confined space standard, at a depth of 5 feet or greater, some form of mechanical means is needed to extract the worker from a vertical confined space. Fourth question is, what should we include in effective rescue plan? Effective rescue plan should include the following procedures: limiting the time the casualty is suspended, rescuing the casualty either self-rescue or by another person, quickly identifying the symptoms and signs of orthostatic intolerance, orthostatic syndrome, harness-induced pathology or suspension trauma. Fifth question is, what are the procedures to stop accident incidents from happening again at workplace? Friends, this is also a very important question. The interviewer asked by repeatedly in the interview process. The detailed assessment and check the effectiveness of existing control measures. If existing control measures is not effective, then provide extra controls. Educate and encourage all workers to report all near misses. Make sure all tools, equipments and machinery is inspected on a daily basis. Only competent workforce should be allowed for the job. Proper communication and coordination with employees and employer that can encourage workers to pressure-free environment. Job rotation and proper breaks during work that prevent tiredness and stress that can lead incident. Post signboards with pictogram and visible points places. Provide appropriate workplace with proper welfare facilities. Share previous accidents incidents to workers, their causes and consequences. Strictly implement drug and alcohol policy at workplace. Provision of training and supervision. What are the key elements of a permit to work system? Or else the interviewer can ask you, what are the sections in permit to work system? So friends, every organization to organization have their own permit to work system. So here I am going to explain some sections in the permit. It is common for every permit to work system. The essential elements of permit to work systems are permit title. The permit title means it may be hot work, maybe it is confined space entry, working height, spark potential, critical work as per the organization. Permit number. making reference to any other relevant permits or installation certificate. Friends, permit number is specific, every permit having different permit specific number. Job location, identifying the exact location of the planned job. Plant identification, identifying the plant which will be worked on. This will assist in ensuring that the correct plant has been isolated of all energy sources. Description of the work to be done. A breakdown of the full scope of work will be explained in this section. Hazard identification. In this section, identification of all hazard associated with the work to be performed. This information is obtained for the task risk assessment for the job. Precautions necessary. In this section, work-related precautions will be identified. This includes all precautionary measures required to control hazards which have been identified, including persons involved. For example, person responsible for isolation of plant will need to sign and confirm that plant has been isolated. Personal protective equipments. In this section, personal protective equipments will be identified for the job. Energy isolation. In this section, isolation requirement will be explained. Plant operator will ensure isolation and loto requirements. Authorization. In this section, signature by permit issuer confirming that the required precautions has been taken. Information on the duration of the permit must be provided. Zero energy. In this section, field operator will do zero energy demonstration to permit holder. Acceptance. In this section, signatures of all workers involved in the task confirming an understanding of the work to be done, hazards involved and the required precautions as well, and confirmation that the content of the permit has been discussed. Extension shift handover. In this section, signatures confirming that plant remains safe to be worked upon and new workers have been made fully aware of the hazards and precautions involved. Hand back. In this section, signed by the permit receiver confirming that the required work has been completed, as well as the permit issuer confirming that plant is ready for the testing and commissioning. Last section is cancellation. In this section, confirming work test and plant recommissioned. The following need to be considered when developing the permit in addition to the above. Human factors, who will be responsible for ensuring that the permit to work system is correctly and effectively implemented and enforced with employees and contractors. It is the responsibility of the employer to provide instructions, training and supervision on the permit to work system. The employer should also know which operator or employee will need to be trained on the permits. Friends, this all section will be common for all permits. Explain safety devices and operational aids of crane. Safety devices and operational aids must be checked for proper operation during all shift by operators. Safety devices and operational aids must not be used as substitute for the exercise of professional judgment by the crane operator. Crane safety devices like crane level indicators, boom stops, jib stops, foot pedal brake locks, hydraulic outrigger integral check valves, rail clamps on rail mounted devices, horn. These all are 7 points will be considered in crane safety devices. Crane operational aids category 1 like boom hoist limiting device, luffing jib limiting device, anti two block device. These all are crane operational category 1. Crane operational aids category 2. Boom angle or radius indicator, luffing jib angle indicator, boom length indicator, load weighing and similar devices, outrigger stabilizer position sensors monitor, hoist drum rotation indicator. These all points will be considered in crane operational aids category 2. If any safety device listed is not in proper working order, then equipment must be taken out of service until the device is working properly. Alternative measures are not permitted to be used. What are the hazards related to petroleum industry? This question also very important, my dear friends. The interview will be asked by repeatedly in the interview process. There are many hazards related to petroleum industry, such as breathing petrol fumes is dangerous. Exposure to vapor concentrations can cause respiratory irritation, headache, dizziness, nausea, and loss of coordination. Higher concentrations may cause loss of consciousness, cardiac sensation, coma, and death resulting from respiratory failure. Environmental hazards of petroleum. When petroleum spills, pollute surface water. Here we will see oil and gas industry hazards. There are main some specific hazards like fire and explosions, stuck by caught between mechanical hazards, vehicle collisions, falls, hot surfaces, confined spaces, exposure to hazardous chemicals, ergonomical hazards, high pressure line and equipment, electrical hazards and other hazardous energy, etc. These all are main hazards in oil and gas. What is logout and tagout and why Lotto required? Give some examples of Lotto requirements. Friends, this is also very most important question in oil and gas industry. Also, it will be asked in the during shutdown interviews. Friends, will understand here logout and tagout. Logout and tagout is a process to block the flow of energy from the source, and it will locked with the lock system or padlock for not restore the energy, and this should be tagged on it. The tag will be as warning, do not operate. Why Lotto require? When machine or equipment are being prepared for a service or maintenance, they often contain some form of hazardous energy that can cause harm to people in the area. Hazardous energy mean any type of energy that can be released and might harm a person. This could include energy of the following types like chemical, electrical, hydraulic, mechanical, pneumatic, thermal, other source of energy. Examples of Lotto requirements. Without the use of proper Lotto safety procedures, the serviced equipment can unexpectedly start up or otherwise release the form of energy. This can lead to injuries and even death to the people working on the machine and even to others working in the area or living in the community. Now consider some examples of injuries without using logout and tagout. First example, a worker is servicing a press. Another worker comes by and starts the press, and the service worker is caught up in the press, causing an amputation. Second example is workers are repairing a connection in piping, and somewhere up that some line, another worker open a valve, sending fluids down the pipe, the ultimately spill on and burn the maintenance workers. Third example is a conveyor jumps. A worker reaches in to try to clean the jam. The conveyor jumps is suddenly and unexpectedly freed, and the worker is crushed as a result. Fourth example is a worker is servicing a machine, and the same time internal wiring is the machine shorts, causing the maintenance worker to be shocked. The 10th question is, what can be source of H2S? Where H2S can be found? Hydrogen sulfide is produced naturally from decaying organic matter. It can be released from sewage sludge, liquid manure, and surface hot spiring and with natural gas. It is also used or is a byproduct in many industrial processes such as petroleum production and refining, sewer and wastewater treatment, agricultural silos and pits, textile manufacturing, pulp and paper processing, food processing, hot asphalt, paving, mining. Many workers are at risk for exposure to hydrogen sulfide, especially when working in confined spaces. For example, sanitation workers can be exposed when cleaning or maintaining municipal sewers and septic tanks. Farm workers can be exposed when cleaning manure storage tanks or working in manure pits. Workers in oil and gas, natural gas, drilling and refining may be exposed because of hydrogen sulfide may be present in oil and gas deposits and is a byproduct of desulfurization process of these fuels. Confined spaces where hydrogen sulfide can build up to dangerous level. Windless are low-lying area that increase the potential for packets of hydrogen sulfide form. Marshy landscapes where bacteria break down organic matter to form hydrogen sulfide. Hot weather that speed up rotting of manure and other organic material and increase the hydrogen sulfide vapor pressure. My dear HSC professionals, I hope this video is very helpful to you all and also very useful who are preparing for HSC interview. Friends, I will upload more videos related to HSC interview technical question and answers soon. So friends, stay connected with us. Please subscribe our channel.